Aids to Reflection and Other Works. By Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Edited by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 2 of 22. Aids to Reflection. Continues. Introductory Aphorisms. Continues. 23. The outward service of ancient religion, the rites, ceremonies, and ceremonial vestments of the old law, had morality for their substance. They were the letter, of which morality was the spirit, the enigma, of which morality was the meaning. But morality itself is the service and ceremonial, cultus exterior, of the Christian religion. The scheme of grace and truth that became through Jesus Christ, the faith that looks down into the perfect law of liberty, has light for its garment, its very robe is righteousness. Comment. Herein the Apostle places the preeminence, the peculiar and distinguishing excellence, of the Christian religion. The ritual is of the same kind, though not of the same order, with the religion itself, not arbitrary or conventional, as types and hieroglyphics are in relation to the things expressed by them, but inseparable, consubstantiated, as it were, and partaking therefore of the same life, permanence, and intrinsic worth with its spirit and principle. See the Epistle of St. James 1:26-27, where, in the Authorized Version, the Greek word is rendered religion, whether by mistake or inspiration of the translator, or from the intended sense having become obsolete, I cannot decide. At all events, for the English reader of Coleridge's times, it has the effect of an erroneous translation. It not only obscures the connection of the passage, and weakens the peculiar force and sublimity of the thought, rendering it comparatively flat and trivial, almost indeed tautological, but has occasioned this particular verse to be perverted into a support of a very dangerous error, and the whole epistle to be considered as a set-off against the epistles and declarations of St. Paul, instead of, what in fact it is, a masterly comment and confirmation of the same. I need not inform the religious reader, that James 1:27, is the favorite text and most boasted authority of those divines who represent the Redeemer of the world as little more than a moral reformer, and the Christian faith as a code of ethics, differing from the moral system of Moses and the prophets by an additional motive, or rather, by the additional strength and clearness which the historical fact of the resurrection has given to the same motive. The Greek word unites in itself the two senses of began to exist and was made to exist. It exemplifies the force of the middle voice, in distinction from the verb reflex. In answer to a note on John 1:2, in the Unitarian version of the New Testament, I think it worth noticing, that the same word is used in the very same sense by Aristophanes in that famous parody on the cosmogonies of the mythic poets, or the creation of the finite, as delivered, or supposed to be delivered, in the Cabric or Samothracian mysteries, in the comedy of the birds. James 1:25. The Greek word, parakupsis, signifies the incurvation or bending of the body in the act of looking down into, as, for instance, in the endeavor to see the reflected image of a star in the water at the bottom of a well. A more happy or forcible word could not have been chosen to express the nature and ultimate object of reflection, and to enforce the necessity of it, in order to discover the living fountain and springhead of the evidence of the Christian faith in the believer himself, and at the same time to point out the seat and region, where alone it is to be found. Quantum sumus, simus. That which we find within ourselves, which is more than ourselves, and yet the ground of whatever is good and permanent therein, is the substance and life of all other knowledge. The Fomulists of the 16th century, and similar enthusiasts of later date, overlooked the essential point, that it was a law, and a law that involved its own end, a perfect law or law that perfects or completes itself, and therefore, its obligations are called, in reference to human statutes, imperfect duties, i.e. incoequible from without. They overlooked that it was a law that portions out to each man the sphere and limits within which it is to be exercised, which, as St. Peter notices of certain profound passages in the writings of St. Paul. 2 Peter 3:16. 24. Morality is the body, of which the faith in Christ is the soul, so far indeed its earthly body, as it is adapted to its state of warfare on earth, and the appointed form and instrument of its communion with the present world, yet not terrestrial, nor of the world, but a celestial body, and capable of being transfigured from glory to glory, in accordance with the varying circumstances and outward relations of its moving and informing spirit. 25. Woe to the man, who will believe neither power, freedom, nor morality, because he nowhere finds either entire, or unmixed with sin, thraldom, and infirmity. In the natural and intellectual realms, we distinguish what we cannot separate, and in the moral world, we must distinguish in order to separate. Yeah, in the clear distinction of good from evil the process of separation commences. Comment. It was customary with religious men in former times, to make a rule of taking every morning some text, or aphorism, for their occasional meditation during the day, and thus to fill up the intervals of their attention to business. I do not point it out for imitation, as knowing too well, how apt these self-imposed rules are to degenerate into superstition or hollowness, otherwise I would have recommended the following as the first exercise. In accordance with a preceding remark, on the use of etymology in disciplining the youthful mind to thoughtful habits, and as consistent with the title of this work, Aids to Reflection, I shall offer no apology for the following and similar notes. Aphorism, determinate position, from the Greek, ap, from, and horizon, to bound or limit, whence our horizon. In order to get the full sense of a word, we should first present to our minds the visual image that forms its primary meaning. Draw lines of different colors round the different counties of England, and then cut out each separately, as in the common play maps that children take to pieces and put together, so that each district can be contemplated apart from the rest, as a whole in itself. This twofold act of circumscribing, and detaching, when it is exerted by the mind on subjects of reflection and reason, is to aphorize, and the result an aphorism. 26. It is a dull and obtuse mind, that must divide in order to distinguish, but it is a still worse, that distinguishes in order to divide. In the former, we may contemplate the source of superstition and idolatry, in the latter, of schism, heresy, and a seditious and sectarian spirit. That is, they divided the intelligible into many and several individualities. Though well aware of its formal and apparent derivation from herio, I am inclined to refer both words to ero, as the primitive term, containing the primary visual image, and therefore should explain heresis, as a willful raising into public notice, an uplifting, for display, of any particular opinion differing from the established belief of the church at large, and making it a ground of schism, that is, division. I mean these words in their large and philosophic sense in relation to the spirit, or originating temper and tendency, and not to any one mode under which, or to any one class, in or by which it may be displayed. A seditious spirit may, it is possible, though not probable, exist in the council chamber of a palace as strongly as in a mob in palace yard, and a sectarian spirit in a cathedral, no less than in a conventicle. 27. Exclusive of the abstract sciences, the largest and worthiest portion of our knowledge consists of aphorisms, and the greatest and best of men is but an aphorism. 28. On the prudential influence which the fear or foresight of the consequences of his actions, in respect of his own loss or gain, may exert on a newly converted believer. Precautionary remark, I meddle not with the dispute respecting conversion, whether, and in what sense, necessary in all Christians. It is sufficient for my purpose, that a very large number of men, even in Christian countries, need to be converted, and that not a few, I trust, have been. The tenet becomes fanatical and dangerous, only when rare and extraordinary exceptions are made to be the general rule, when what was vouchsafed to the apostle of the Gentiles by a special grace, and for an especial purpose, namely, a conversion begun and completed in the same moment, is demanded or expected of all men, as a necessary sign and pledge of their election. Late observations have shown, that under many circumstances the magnetic needle, even after the disturbing influence has been removed, will keep wavering, and require many days before it points aright, and remains steady to the pole. So is it ordinarily with the soul, after it has begun to free itself from the disturbing forces of the flesh and the world, and to convert itself towards God. Whereas Christ's other disciples had a breeding under him, Saint Paul was born an apostle, not carved out, as the rest, by degrees and in course of time, but a fusel apostle, an apostle poured out and cast in a mold. As Adam was a perfect man in an instant, so was Saint Paul a perfect Christian. The same spirit was the lightning that melted, and the mold that received and shaped him, Dunn's sermons, quoted from memory. From the Latin, convertir, that is, by an act of the will to turn towards the true pole, at the same time, for this is the force of the prepositive con, that the understanding is convinced and made aware of its existence and direction. 29. Awakened by the cock crow, a sermon, a calamity, a sick bed, or a providential escape, the Christian pilgrim sets out in the morning twilight, while yet the truth is below the horizon. Certain necessary consequences of his past life and his present undertaking will be seen by the refraction of its light, more will be apprehended and conjectured. The phantasms, that had predominated during the hours of darkness, are still busy. Though they no longer present themselves as distinct forms, they yet remain as formative motions in the pilgrim's soul, unconscious of its own activity and overmastered by its own workmanship. Things take the signature of thought. The shapes of the recent dream become a mold for the objects in the distance, and these again give an outwardness and a sensation of reality to the shapings of the dream. The bodings inspired by the long habit of selfishness, and self-seeking cunning, though they are now commencing the process of their purification into that fear which is the beginning of wisdom, and which, as such, is ordained to be our guide and safeguard, till the Son of Love, the perfect law of liberty, is fully arisen, these bodings will set the fancy at work, and haply, for a time, transform the mists of dim and imperfect knowledge into determinate superstitions. But in either case, whether seen clearly or dimly, whether beholden or only imagined, the consequences, contemplated in their bearings on the individual's inherent desire of happiness and dread of pain, become motives, and, unless all distinction in the words be done away with, and either prudence or virtue be reduced to a superfluous synonym, a redundancy in all the languages of the civilized world, these motives and the acts and forbearances directly proceeding from them, fall under the head of prudence, as belonging to one or other of its four very distinct species. A. It may be a prudence, that stands in opposition to a higher moral life, and tends to preclude it, and to prevent the soul from ever arriving at the hatred of sin for its own exceeding sinfulness, Romans 7:13, and this is an evil prudence. B. Or it may be a neutral prudence, not incompatible with spiritual growth, and to this we may, with a special propriety, apply the words of our Lord, "What is not against us is for us." It is therefore an innocent, and, being such, a proper, and commendable prudence. C. Or it may lead and be subservient to a higher principle than itself. The mind and conscience of the individual may be reconciled to it, in the foreknowledge of the higher principle, and with a yearning towards it that implies a foretaste of future freedom. The enfeebled convalescent is reconciled to his crutches, and thankfully makes use of them, not only because they are necessary for his immediate support, but likewise, because they are the means and conditions of exercise, and by exercise, of establishing, graded impolitim, that strength, flexibility, and almost spontaneous obedience of the muscles, which the idea and cheering presentiment of health hold out to him. He finds their value in their present necessity, and their worth as they are the instruments of finally superseding it. This is a faithful, a wise prudence, having indeed, its birthplace in the world, and the wisdom of this world for its father, but naturalized in a better land, and having the wisdom from above for its sponsor and spiritual parent. To steal a dropped feather from the spicy nest of the phoenix, the fond humor, I mean, of the mystic divines and elegiacs of Holy Writ, it is the son of Terah from Ur of the Chaldees, who gives a tithe of all to the King of Righteousness, without father, without mother, without descent, and receives a blessing on the remainder. D. Lastly, there is a prudence that coexists with morality, as morality coexists with the spiritual life, a prudence that is the organ of both, as the understanding is to the reason and the will, or as the lungs are to the heart and brain. This is a holy prudence, the steward faithful and discreet, Luke 12, 42, the eldest servant in the family of faith, born in the house, and made the ruler over his Lord's household. Let not, then, I entreat you, my purpose be misunderstood, as if, in distinguishing virtue from prudence, I wished to divide the one from the other. True morality is hostile to that prudence only, which is preclusive of true morality. The teacher, who subordinates prudence to virtue, cannot be supposed to dispense with it, and he who teaches the proper connection of the one with the other, does not depreciate the lower in any sense, while by making it a link of the same chain with the higher, and receiving the same influence, he raises it. In general, morality may be compared to the consonant, prudence to the vowel. The former cannot be uttered, reduced to practice, but by means of the latter. The following extract from Leighton's Theological Lectures, Section 2 may serve as a comment on this sentence. The human mind, however stunned and weakened by the fall, still retains some faint idea of the good it has lost, a kind of languid sense of its misery and indigence, with affection suitable to these obscure notions. This at least is beyond all doubt and indisputable, that all men wish well to themselves, nor can the mind divest itself of this propensity, without divesting itself of its being. This is what the schoolmen mean, when in their manner of expression they say, that the will, voluntas, not arbitrium, is carried towards happiness not simply as will, but as nature. I venture to remark that this position, if not more certainly would be more evidently true, if instead of beatitudo, the word indolentia, that is, freedom from pain, negative happiness, had been used. But this depends on the exact meaning attached to the term self, of which more in another place. One conclusion, however, follows inevitably from the preceding position, namely, that this propensity can never be legitimately made the principle of morality, even because it is no part or appurtenance of the moral will, and because the proper object of the moral principle is to limit and control this propensity, and to determine in what it may be, and in what it ought to be gratified, while it is the business of philosophy to instruct the understanding, and the office of religion to convince the whole man, that otherwise than as a regulated, and of course therefore a subordinate, and, this propensity, innate and inalienable though it be, can never be realized or fulfilled. 30. What the duties of morality are, the Apostle instructs the believer in full, comprising them under the two heads of negative and positive, negative, to keep himself pure from the world, and positive, beneficence from loving kindness, that is, love of his fellow men, his kind, as himself. 31. Last and highest, come the spiritual, comprising all the truths, acts, and duties that have an especial reference to the timeless, the permanent, the eternal, to the sincere love of the true, as truth, of the good, as good, and of God as both in one. It comprehends the whole ascent from uprightness, morality, virtue, inward rectitude, to godlikeness, with all the acts, exercises, and disciplines of mind, will, and affection, that are requisite or conducive to the great design of our redemption from the form of the evil one, and of our second creation or birth in the divine image. It is worthy of observation, and may furnish a fruitful subject for future reflection, how nearly this scriptural division coincides with the Platonic, which, commencing with the prudential, or the habit of act and purpose proceeding from enlightened self-interest, qui animi imperio, corpora servicio, rerum auxilio, in proprium sui commodum et sibi provigis iudeter, hunc esse prudentum statuimus ascends to the moral, that is, to the purifying and remedial virtues, and seeks its summit in the imitation of the divine nature. In this last division, answering to that which we have called the spiritual, Plato includes all those inward acts and aspirations, waitings, and watchings, which have a growth in godlikeness for their immediate purpose, and the union of the human soul with the supreme good as their ultimate object. Nor was it altogether without grounds that several of the fathers ventured to believe that Plato had some dim conception of the necessity of a divine mediator, whether through some indistinct echo of the patriarchal faith, or some rays of light refracted from the Hebrew prophets through a Phoenician medium, to which he may possibly have referred in his phrase, the wisdom delivered from God, or by his own sense of the mysterious contradiction in human nature between the will and the reason. The natural appetences and the not less innate law of conscience, Romans 2, 14-15, we shall in vain attempt to determine. It is not impossible that all three may have cooperated in partially unveiling these awful truths to this plank from the wreck of paradise thrown on the shores of idolatrous Greece, to this divine philosopher. Che en quella sciura ando piu presso al segno al quale iunge, a chi dal cielo e dato. Petrarch, Del Trionfo della Fama, Chapter 3, 5-6. 32. It may be an additional aid to reflection, to distinguish the three kinds severally, according to the faculty to which each corresponds, the part of our human nature which is more particularly its organ. Thus, the prudential corresponds to the sense and the understanding, the moral to the heart and the conscience, the spiritual to the will and the reason, that is, to the finite will reduced to harmony with, and in subordination to, the reason, as a ray from that true light which is both reason and will, universal reason, and will absolute. Reflections. Introductory to Moral and Religious Aphorisms on Sensibility. If prudence, though practically inseparable from morality, is not to be confounded with the moral principle, still less may sensibility, that is, a constitutional quickness of sympathy with pain and pleasure, and a keen sense of the gratifications that accompany social intercourse, mutual endearments, and reciprocal preferences, be mistaken, or deemed a substitute for either. Sensibility is not even a sure pledge of a good heart, though among the most common meanings of that many meaning and too commonly misapplied expression. So far from being either morality, or one with the moral principle, it ought not even to be placed in the same rank with prudence. For prudence is at least an offspring of the understanding, but sensibility, the sensibility, I mean, here spoken of, is for the greater part a quality of the nerves, and a result of individual bodily temperament. Prudence is an active principle, and implies a sacrifice of self, though only to the same self projected, as it were, to a distance. But the very term sensibility, marks its passive nature, and in its mere self, apart from choice and reflection, it proves little more than the coincidence or contagion of pleasurable or painful sensations in different persons. Alas! How many are there in this overstimulated age, in which the occurrence of excessive and unhealthy sensitiveness is so frequent, as even to have reversed the current meaning of the word, nervous? How many are there whose sensibility prompts them to remove those evils alone, which by hideous spectacle or clamorous outcry are present to their senses and disturb their selfish enjoyments? Provided the dunghill is not before their parlor window, they are contented to know that it exists, and perhaps as the hotbed on which their own luxuries are reared. Sensibility is not necessarily benevolence. Nay, by rendering us tremblingly alive to trifling misfortunes, it frequently prevents it, and induces an effeminate selfishness instead. Pampering the coward heart, with feelings all too delicate for use. Sweet are the tears, that from a howard's eye drop on the cheek of one, he lifts from earth, and he, who works me good with unmoved face, does it but half. He chills me, while he aids, my benefactor, not my brother man. But even this cold benevolence, seems worth, seems manhood, when there rise before me, the sluggard pity's vision-weaving tribe, who sigh for wretchedness yet shun the wretched, nursing in some delicious solitude, their slothful loves and dainty sympathies. Lastly, where virtue is, sensibility is the ornament and becoming attire of virtue. On certain occasions it may almost be said to become virtue. But sensibility and all the amiable qualities may likewise become, and too often have become, the panders of vice and the instruments of seduction. So must it needs be with all qualities that have their rise only in parts and fragments of our nature. A man of warm passions may sacrifice half his estate to rescue a friend from prison, for he is naturally sympathetic, and the more social part of his nature happened to be uppermost. The same man shall afterwards exhibit the same disregard of money in an attempt to seduce that friend's wife or daughter. All the evil achieved by Hobbes, and the whole school of materialists will appear inconsiderable, if it be compared with the mischief effected and occasioned by the sentimental philosophy of Sterne, and his numerous imitators. The vilest appetites and the most remorseless inconstancy towards their objects, acquired the titles of the heart, the irresistible feelings, the too tender sensibility, and if the frosts of prudence, the icy chains of human law thawed and vanished at the genial warmth of human nature, who could help it? It was an amiable weakness. About this time, too, the profanation of the word love rose to its height. The French naturalists, Buffon and others, borrowed it from the sentimental novelists, the Swedish and English philosophers took the contagion, and the muse of science condescended to seek admission into the saloons of fashion and frivolity, rouged like a harlot, and with the harlot's wanton leer. I know not how the annals of guilt could be better forced into the service of virtue, than by such a comment on the present paragraph, as would be afforded by a selection from the sentimental correspondence produced in courts of justice within the last 30 years, fairly translated into the true meaning of the words, and the actual object and purpose of the infamous writers. Do you in good earnest aim at dignity of character? By all the treasures of a peaceful mind, by all the charms of an open countenance, I conjure you, O youth! Turn away from those who live in the twilight between vice and virtue. Are not reason, discrimination, law, and deliberate choice, the distinguishing characters of humanity? Cannot, then, worthy of a human being, proceed from a habit of soul, which would exclude all these and, to borrow a metaphor from paganism, prefer the den of Trophonius to the temple and oracles of the God of Light. Can anything manly, I say, proceed from those, who for law and light would substitute shapeless feelings, sentiments, impulses, which as far as they differ from the vital workings in the brute animals, owe the difference to their former connection with the proper virtues of humanity, as dendrites derive the outlines, that constitute their value above other claystones, from the casual neighborhood and pressure of the plants, the names of which they assume? Remember, that love itself in its highest earthly bearing, as the ground of the marriage union, becomes love by an inward fiat of the will, by a completing and sealing act of moral election, and lays claim to permanence only under the form of duty. There sometimes occurs an apparent play on words, which not only to the moralizer, but even to the philosophical etymologist, appears more than a mere play. Thus in the double sense of the word, become. I have known persons so anxious to have their dress become them, as to convert it at length into their proper self, and thus actually to become the dress. Such a one, safeliest spoken of by the neuter pronoun, I consider as but a suit of live finery. It is indifferent whether we say, it becomes he, or, he becomes it. It might be a mean of preventing many unhappy marriages, if the youth of both sexes had it early impressed on their minds, that marriage contracted between Christians is a true and perfect symbol or mystery, that is, the actualizing faith being supposed to exist in the receivers, it is an outward sign coessential with that which it signifies, or a living part of that, the whole of which it represents. Marriage, therefore, in the Christian sense, Ephesians 5:22-33, as symbolical of the union of the soul with Christ the Mediator, and with God through Christ, is perfectly a sacramental ordinance, and not retained by the Reformed churches as one of the sacraments, for two reasons: first, that the sign is not distinctive of the Church of Christ, and the ordinance not peculiar nor owing its origin to the gospel dispensation; secondly, it is not of universal obligation, not a means of grace enjoined on all Christians. In other and plainer words, marriage does not contain in itself an open profession of Christ, and it is not a sacrament of the Church, but only of certain individual members of the Church. It is evident, however, that neither of these reasons affect or diminish the religious nature and dedicative force of the marriage vow, or detract from the solemnity in the apostolic declaration, this is a great mystery. The interest which the state has in the appropriation of one woman to one man, and the civil obligations therefrom resulting, form an altogether distinct consideration. When I meditate on the words of the Apostle, confirmed and illustrated as they are, by so many harmonies in the spiritual structure of our proper humanity, in the image of God, male and female created he the man, and then reflect how little claim so large a number of legal cohabitations have to the name of Christian marriages, I feel inclined to doubt whether the plan of celebrating marriages universally by the civil magistrate, in the first instance, and leaving the religious covenant and sacramental pledge to the election of the parties themselves, adopted during the Republic in England, and in our own times by the French legislature, was not in fact, whatever it might be in intention, reverential to Christianity. At all events, it was their own act and choice, if the parties made bad worse by the profanation of a gospel mystery. Prudential aphorisms. 1. Leighton and Coleridge. With respect to any final aim or end, the greater part of mankind live at hazard. They have no certain harbor in view, nor direct their course by any fixed star. But to him that knoweth not the port to which he is bound, no wind can be favorable, neither can he who has not yet determined at what mark he is to shoot, direct his arrow aright. It is not, however, the less true, that there is a proper object to aim at, and if this object be meant by the term happiness, though I think that not the most appropriate term for a state, the perfection of which consists in the exclusion of all hap that is, chance, I assert that there is such a thing as human happiness, as summum bonum, or ultimate good. What this is, the Bible alone shows clearly and certainly, and points out the way that leads to the attainment of it. This is that which prevailed with Saint Augustine to study the Scriptures, and engaged his affection to them. In Cicero and Plato and other such writers, says he, I meet with many things acutely said, and things that excite a certain warmth of emotion, but in none of them do I find these words, Come unto me, all ye that labor, and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Comment. Felicity, in its proper sense, is but another word for fortunateness or happiness, and I can see no advantage in the improper use of words, when proper terms are to be found, but, on the contrary, much mischief. 4. By familiarizing the mind to equivocal expressions, that is, such as may be taken in two or more different meanings, we introduce confusion of thought, and furnish the sophist with his best and handiest tools. For the juggle of sophistry consists, for the greater part, in using a word in one sense in the premise, and in another sense in the conclusion. We should accustom ourselves to think, and reason, in precise and steadfast terms, even when custom, or the deficiency, or the corruption of the language will not permit the same strictness in speaking. The mathematician finds this so necessary to the truths which he is seeking, that his science begins with, and is founded on, the definition of his terms. The botanist, the chemist, the anatomist, etc., feel and submit to this necessity at all costs, even at the risk of exposing their several pursuits to the ridicule of the many, by technical terms, hard to be remembered, and alike quarrelsome to the ear and the tongue. In the business of moral and religious reflection, in the acquisition of clear and distinct conceptions of our duties, and of the relations in which we stand to God, our neighbor, and ourselves, no such difficulties occur. At the utmost we have only to rescue words, already existing and familiar, from the false or vague meanings imposed on them by carelessness, or by the clipping and debasing misusage of the market. And surely happiness, duty, faith, truth, and final blessedness, are matters of deeper and dearer interest for all men, than circles to the geometrician, or the characters of plants to the botanist, or the affinities and combining principle of the elements of bodies to the chemist, or even than the mechanism, fearful and wonderful though it be, of the perishable tabernacle of the soul can be to the anatomist. Among the aids to reflection, place the following maxim prominent: let distinctness in expression advance side by side with distinction in thought. For one useless subtlety in our elder divines and moralists, I will produce 10 sophisms of equivocation in the writings of our modern preceptors, and for one error resulting from excess in distinguishing the indifferent, I would show 10 mischievous delusions from the habit of confounding the diverse. Whether you are reflecting for yourself, or reasoning with another, make it a rule to ask yourself the precise meaning of the word, on which the point in question appears to turn, and if it may be, that is, by writers of authority has been, used in several senses, then ask which of these the word is at present intended to convey. By this mean, and scarcely without it, you will at length acquire a facility in detecting the quid pro quo. And believe me, in so doing you will enable yourself to disarm and expose 4/5 of the main arguments of our most renowned irreligious philosophers, ancient and modern. For the quid pro quo is at once the rock and quarry, on and with which the strongholds of disbelief, materialism, and, more pernicious still, Epicurean morality are built. Apud Ciceronum et Platonum, aliasque agesmodi scriptores, multa sunt acute dicta, et lenitor calentia, sed in iis omnibus hoc non invenio, venite ad me, etc. Matthew 12, 28. 2. Leighton. If we seriously consider what religion is, we shall find the saying of the wise King Solomon to be unexceptionably true: her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. Doth religion require anything of us more than that we live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world? Now what, I pray, can be more pleasant or peaceable than these? Temperance is always at leisure, luxury always in a hurry, the latter weakens the body and pollutes the soul, the former is the sanctity, purity, and sound state of both. It is one of Epicurus' fixed maxims, that life can never be pleasant without virtue. Comment. In the works of moralists, both Christian and pagan, it is often asserted, indeed there are few commonplaces of more frequent recurrence, that the happiness even of this life consists solely, or principally, in virtue, that virtue is the only happiness of this life, that virtue is the truest pleasure, etc. I doubt not that the meaning, which the writers intended to convey by these and the like expressions, was true and wise. But I deem it safer to say, that in all the outward relations of this life, in all our outward conduct and actions, both in what we should do, and in what we should abstain from, the dictates of virtue are the very same with those of self-interest, tending to, though they do not proceed from, the same point. For the outward object of virtue being the greatest producible sum of happiness of all men, it must needs include the object of an intelligent self-love, which is the greatest possible happiness of one individual, for what is true of all, must be true of each. Hence, you cannot become better, that is, more virtuous, but you will become happier, and you cannot become worse, that is, more vicious, without an increase of misery, or at the best a proportional loss of enjoyment, as the consequence. If the thing were not inconsistent with our well-being, and known to be so, it would not have been classed as a vice. Thus what in an enfeebled and disordered mind is called prudence, is the voice of nature in a healthful state, as is proved by the known fact, that the prudential duties, that is, those actions which are commanded by virtue because they are prescribed by prudence, the animals fulfill by natural instinct. The pleasure that accompanies or depends on a healthy and vigorous body will be the consequence and reward of a temperate life and habits of active industry, whether this pleasure were or were not the chief or only determining motive thereto. Virtue may, possibly, add to the pleasure a good of another kind, a higher good, perhaps, than the worldly mind is capable of understanding, a spiritual complacency, of which in your present sensualized state you can form no idea. It may add, I say, but it cannot detract from it. Thus the reflected rays of the sun that gave light, distinction, and endless multiformity to the mind, afford at the same time the pleasurable sensation of warmth to the body. If then the time has not yet come for anything higher, act on the maxim of seeking the most pleasure with the least pain, and, if only you do not seek where you yourself know it will not be found, this very pleasure and this freedom from the disquieted of pain may produce in you a state of being directly and indirectly favorable to the germination and upspring of a nobler seed. If it be true, that men are miserable because they are wicked, it is likewise true, that many men are wicked because they are miserable. Health, cheerfulness, and easy circumstances, the ordinary consequence of temperance and industry, will at least leave the field clear and open, will tend to preserve the scales of the judgment even, while the consciousness of possessing the esteem, respect, and sympathy of your neighbors, and the sense of your own increasing power and influence, can scarcely fail to give a tone of dignity to your mind, and incline you to hope nobly of your own being. And thus they may prepare and predispose you to the sense and acknowledgement of a principle, differing not merely in degree but in kind from the faculties and instincts of the higher and more intelligent species of animals, the ant, the beaver, the elephant, and which principle is therefore your proper humanity. And on this account and with this view alone may certain modes of pleasurable or agreeable sensation, without confusion of terms, be honored with the title of refined, intellectual, ennobling pleasures. For pleasure, and happiness in its proper sense is but the continuity and sum total of the pleasure which is allotted or happens to a man, and hence by the Greeks called good hap, or more religiously, favorable providence, pleasure, I say, consists in the harmony between the specific excitability of a living creature, and the exciting causes correspondent thereto. Considered therefore exclusively in and for itself, the only question is, quantum, not quali. How much on the whole? The contrary, that is, the painful and disagreeable having been subtracted. The quality is a matter of taste, et de gustibus non est disputandum. No man can judge for another. This, I repeat, appears to me a safer language than the sentences quoted above, that virtue alone is happiness, that happiness consists in virtue, etc., sayings which I find it hard to reconcile with other positions of still more frequent occurrence in the same divines, or with the declaration of Saint Paul, if in this life only we have hope, we are of all men most miserable. At all events, I should rely far more confidently on the converse, namely, that to be vicious is to be miserable. Few men are so utterly reprobate, so embrooded by their vices, as not to have some lucid, or at least quiet and sober, intervals, and in such a moment, dum deceivunt ire, few can stand up unshaken against the appeal to their own experience, what have been the wages of sin? What has the devil done for you? What sort of master have you found him? Then let us in befitting detail, and by a series of questions that ask no loud, and are secure against any false, answer, urge home the proof of the position, that to be vicious is to be wretched, adding the fearful corollary, that if even in the body, which as long as life is in it can never be wholly bereaved of pleasurable sensations, vice is found to be misery, what must it not be in the world to come? There, where even the crime is no longer possible, much less the gratifications that once attended it, where nothing of vice remains but its guilt and its misery, vice must be misery itself, all and utter misery, so best, if I err not, may the motives of prudence be held forth, and the impulses of self-love be awakened, in alliance with truth, and free from the danger of confounding things, the laws of duty, I mean, and the maxims of interest, which it deeply concerns us to keep distinct. Inasmuch as this distinction and the faith therein are essential to our moral nature, and this again the groundwork and precondition of the spiritual state, in which the humanity strives after godliness, and, in the name and power, and through the prevenient and assisting grace, of the Mediator, will not strive in vain. The advantages of a life passed in conformity with the precepts of virtue and religion, and in how many and various respects they recommend virtue and religion, even on grounds of prudence, form a delightful subject of meditation, and a source of refreshing thought to good and pious men. Nor is it strange if, transported with the view, such persons should sometimes discourse on the charms of forms and colors to men whose eyes are not yet couched, or that they occasionally seem to invert the relations of cause and effect, and forget that there are acts and determinations of the will and affections, the consequences of which may be plainly foreseen, and yet cannot be made our proper and primary motives for such acts and determinations, without destroying or entirely altering the distinct nature and character of the latter. Safran is well informed that wealth and extensive patronage will be the consequence of his obtaining the love and esteem of Constantia. But if the foreknowledge of this consequence were, and were found out to be, Safran's main and determining motive for seeking this love and esteem, and if Constantia were a woman that merited, or was capable of feeling, either the one or the other, would not Safran find, and deservedly too, aversion and contempt in their stead? Wherein, if not in this, differs the friendship of worldlings from true friendship. Without kind offices and useful services, wherever the power and opportunity occur, love would be a hollow pretense. Yet what noble mind would not be offended, if he were thought to value the love for the sake of the services, and not rather the services for the sake of the love? 3. Though prudence in itself is neither virtue nor spiritual holiness, yet without prudence, or in opposition to it, neither virtue nor holiness can exist. 4. Art thou under the tyranny of sin? A slave to vicious habits? At enmity with God, and a skulking fugitive from thy own conscience? Oh, how idle the dispute, whether the listening to the dictates of prudence from prudential and self-interested motives be virtue or merit, when the not listening is guilt, misery, madness, and despair. The best, the most Christian-like pity thou canst show, is to take pity on thy own soul. The best and most acceptable service thou canst render, is to do justice and show mercy to thyself.